Hey, McBick family, it's Pastor Cody coming from my living room, per usual. I'm really excited that I get to be the first devotional in kind of a new series that we're doing about racial reconciliation, how to be anti-racist. If you got to watch our video from Sunday morning, Pastor Lane and Pastor Cindy and myself got to sit down and just talk about the heart behind our staff and our church and what we're trying to go after in this season after the killing of George Floyd. It's really important for us to learn how to speak out, learn how to learn about what's going on, and educate ourselves. And so this is an attempt for us to share with you a little bit from our experiences as a staff, and also to push us as a congregation further into this conversation. How can we combat the evil that is racism to the best of our abilities? So we'll be having these little video devotionals ongoing on Fridays through the summer, and we'd love for you to join us and check them out every Friday when they're released. So a little bit of background about myself, because I'm not sure that all of you would know this. I have two adopted brothers, one older and one younger. One was adopted when I was in sixth grade and he was in eighth grade, and one was adopted when I was in college, so kind of already out of the house. And both of these brothers are black, and so when I was growing up, I got to know the black experience in a different way because I had a black sibling that was a part of my family, and then later on two black siblings. But the problem with my mindset around this was I thought because I had black siblings that there was no way that I could be racist, there was no way that I could even be accused of being racist because I had black siblings, so I understood black culture, right? Like, I loved black people clearly because they were in my family. And the problem with this is it created a lot of blind spots in my mind as to areas where I probably do have bias, areas where I've built new biases or new racist thoughts because I have black siblings. And so when I walk through that now, that this conversation is really coming to light, I have to look inside and ask myself a lot of questions. Since I didn't really do the digging while I was growing up, because I just blanket statement said, I have friends who are people of color, I have black brothers, so I can't have any racist thoughts. Because I blanket statemented that when I was growing up, I now have to do a lot of digging myself. And my devotional basically has to do with that, that we need to be people who become learners during this season. Historically, as a white man, I have been in the majority. I have held the positions of power. And I'm not talking about me specifically, but white men throughout history of our country. And so I haven't really had to learn what it's like to be a minority. I haven't had to learn even what it's like to be a woman in this country. I haven't had any of those experiences. And so my mindset is really limited when it comes to people who have any sort of minority experience. So what I'm realizing during this time is it's my job. I really feel like it's my job and duty to educate myself with the stories of people who look and have different, who look differently than me and have different experiences than me. One of the things that I've been trying to do is surround myself with more black and brown voices, because, you know, we live in an area that is predominantly white. We go to a church that is predominantly white. And my friend group out here, there are some people of color in it, but it's predominantly white. And so the voices that I'm hearing consistently are white. And that's not an evil or bad thing. It's kind of a product of where I live currently. But it means I need to take the extra step in educating myself and hearing different voices. So one of the ways that I'm doing that right now is I'm reading this book. It's called I'm Still Here, Black Dignity in a World Made for Whiteness. It's by Austin Channing Brown. And I am reading this book because it is more of a memoir. I'm also reading another book that's more of a history lesson, but this book is really a memoir of Austin's life. She is a black female in this country, similar age to me. And she starts out the book just by saying, you know, I asked my mom why I was named Austin Brown. And her mom said, you know, this, I named you that because it's a white man's name. So later, you know, when you're applying for jobs, if people just look at your resume, just see your name, I want them to pick you. I want them to choose you. And that, you know, that's in the first like chapter of this book. That's a wake-up call to a lot of us. We're like, man, I've never had to think through something like that. My name is just my name, and I'm a white man, so I'd never thought, okay, people aren't going to look at my resume because I have some sort of different name. So from the very first chapter, it's eye-opening to me, and it just continues on in that direction. And so what I want to encourage y'all with is, who are the people that you can start hearing stories from, that you can be educated from, whether that's reading books, following people on social media, watching different types of TV, documentary movies, where can you get some different voices? I used this example with a student the other day, about if I was moving to, say, France, I wanted to live in France. There's a couple ways I could go about figuring out if living in France was good, if people liked living in France. I could talk to someone who's never been to France. Okay, probably not my best option. I could talk to someone who visited France for a week and ask them, what's it like to live in France? They would have some perspective, but they probably wouldn't know everything. I could talk to someone who's lived in France their whole life, and they would give me the best perspective. But the problem is, if I only talk to that one person, I would get one person's perspective of living in France. You know, so when we compare this to race and hearing stories from people of different colors, I could read this book by Austin Channing Brown and say, all right, now I understand what it's like to be a black woman in America. It's better than reading a book from a white woman. It's better than reading a book from a white man. And those are true, but it's still one person's experience. And so to the student, I basically said, we need to inundate ourselves and to be hearing from as many voices as possible so that we can really start to understand start to get a glimpse of understanding to what it is like growing up black in America, because I will never understand that. I will never have that in my mindset. So my main focus of this devotional is to become a learner, recognize that we don't know everything, and to start seeking opportunities to learn from voices that are different from ours. Now, before I finish, some of you might be thinking, okay, you haven't said anything about Jesus yet, you haven't talked about God, so is this really a devotional, or are you just trying to get me to do something social justice-y? One of the things in youth group that we focus on a lot is the life and story of Jesus. Every single year, we do like a 5 to 6 week series that just focuses on Jesus's life. And then throughout the year, we revisit the Gospels time and time again. That is the place I want to share the most amount of stories from. Why? Because when I understand Jesus's story, I understand more about what he wants from me. I understand more about how he wants me to live my life. I need to really understand Jesus's story if I'm going to say, I get it. I'm a Christian. I'm following. I'm doing the right thing. I need to know what he's all about and how he lived. I find it similar to experiences of people of different colors than me. I really want to know where they come from in order to feel like I can help, I can be an ally, and that I can do the right thing. I can become a better version of myself, a better person. Not only that, but in Acts, we see this beautiful thing happen where God speaks to the disciples in a couple different ways, but he basically says, hey, this message of Jesus Christ was for the Jews. You guys have been going out preaching to the Jews over and over again, but now I'm opening up that door. I'm swinging it wide and saying that this message is for the Jews and for the Gentiles. And that was a huge moment. We might not think so, but that was a huge moment back then, because instead of the gospel and Jesus Christ just being for this group of chosen people, the gospel all of a sudden got opened up to an entire world of people and basically said, everyone is invited to the table. Everyone is deserving of hearing the good news of Jesus Christ. And so then the disciples pivoted and they changed how they went and brought the gospel. They then went to places where there were Jews and Gentiles, and they spoke to both groups. They started talking to the Greeks, and they started baptizing Greeks and baptizing Jews in the name of Jesus. And I love the picture that that creates, because now all of a sudden it's not Greek versus Jew, it's not slave versus free, it's not male versus female, but this gospel is now for everybody. And in my mind, if this gospel and good news is for everybody, if Jesus's love is for every single person out there, then my love needs to be for every single person too, no matter what they look like. And in order to truly love them, to truly get this gospel message to them, I need to understand who they are. So my challenge to you this week would be find a way to get a brown or black voice incorporated into your life to hear some stories and to recognize Jesus loves all of us and wants us to share his love with everyone. Thanks, McBick. I'm so excited to take this journey with you. Bye.